developing open source firmware for open power systems. Thank you, Stewart.
Thank you. Hello, I'm Stewart. I currently work for IBM. I have the great title of Opal Architect. That's Open Power Abstraction Layer, which is open source firmware for open power systems. Last year, I talked about at LCA the contents of what's in a firmware image and what goes on during boot. So all of the magic before you get to such luxurious things as an operating system, which is some weird future world that's after firmware. This year, I'm not talking about the technical details of firmware or the machine at all. Instead, I'm talking about the much trickier problems, which are related to people. And so I'm going to talk about how we got to here now in the current state of sort of, you know, some of the organizational change we've been going through and how we've been doing. So, you know, good stories, bad stories, and stuff like that. I am not an expert on this topic at all, but I figured the overwhelming majority of people that I'm telling such tricks to are not downright evil, and therefore there will be a net gain in the world in attempting to disseminate some of my experiences and knowledge. So change is inevitable. You can change and thrive, or the world changes and you perish. Remember, Netflix used to rent out DVDs. So did Blockbuster. One changed and did quite well, and the other ones, yeah, remember them? kind of deal. So we've had some pretty significant change in our part of IBM over the past few years. And that part's like the systems group, and specifically power systems, and even more specifically related to Linux and open source. And I'll specify this, which is something you may not be aware of. IBM is big, like really big. Like, you may think it's a long way down to the chemist, but that's nothing to do with how big IBM is. In fact, it's twice the size of Hobart. As in, if you had everyone in Hobart working for IBM, you'd need another Hobart to actually have all the IBM employees. And I've worked with companies at various sizes. So I've worked for companies that were fewer than 100 people, and even doubled in size several times, well, less than 100 people. Ones that were hundreds of people and also went through growth. Tens of thousands of people that went through the opposite of growth. And hundreds of thousands of people, which is IBM. And I would say that sort of the lessons and methods apply equally. There are certainly differences between larger companies and smaller ones, but I would say that the same core ideas translate across and are just applied differently. And I'm going to steal knowledge from people who know it much better than me and provide a quote. This is from a book called The Five Dysfunctions of a Team, a Leadership Fable, which is a great book that helped me a lot in a previous role. If you could get all the people in an organization rowing in the same direction, you could dominate any industry in any market against any competition at any time. Goes on to think that this is actually impossible. But the closer you get, the better things go, right? You're not going to ever achieve perfection, but the more you're going in generally the same direction, the more likely you are to head in that general direction as opposed to go nowhere. Another thing, which is true, is if we express our needs, we have a better chance of getting them met. This is just a general thought. We have many thoughts of what we would like to have happen and needs that we have. If we keep them to ourselves, the likelihood of them being met is much smaller than if we ever express these needs and our thoughts. And so another book that I will recommend, for those who are attending here and on the video, you may not be aware that attending this session contractually obliges you to read the homework that I said at the end. Don't worry, it's only four books. And so how we communicate with one another can make a great difference. So why am I talking about organizational change? Well, simply because you never get to create an organizational team from scratch, right? This basically never happens. More likely, you're going to be part of an existing team and changing it. Or even if you are creating an organizational team from scratch, so you know, creating a startup or a new team and you're handpicking people, well, it's unlikely to be perfect from the start, because designing perfection, as we all know with software, is entirely possible, and version 1.0 is always the best. And besides, the world is going to change. And so we're going to need to adapt to it, and people may change and grow over time, so there's always going to be change going on. So the specific story I want to go through is around OpenPOWER, and it starts with a computer, which this is an IBM one. It's an OpenPOWER system, and it has an open source firmware stack. Right? Well, except in this one, the BMC is still a proprietary firmware stack, but there's OpenBMC, which other people can talk about too, and there's choice on what service processor stacks you have. So we shipped our first OpenPOWER machine in around October 2015. And both IBM and other partners have shipped many OpenPOWER machines since then, including firmware updates. The road to this machine, however, doesn't start with this. This is not 1.0 of everything. We had a step before that, which was KVM on power. So in order to get KVM running on power, we needed some changes. So the traditional IBM power system came with all proprietary hardware, proprietary firmware with a proprietary hypervisor running your proprietary operating system. Of course, you could run Linux as a guest, so you had an open part as a Linux guest underneath that proprietary hypervisor. But in order to get KVM going, you know, you don't want to do nested virtualization because of all the hardware details, rah, rah, rah. So you want to run bare metal. Enter OPAL, the OpenPOWER abstraction layer, to be able to run Linux on the bare metal and then use the partitioning features of the processor to run KVM. And this specific machine here was the first product the Linux Technology Center was so intimately involved in. So we're working on the firmware and something called Power KVM. But at the same time, to get KVM for people using Linux on power, there was this other effort going on, which is called OpenPOWER. And the idea behind that was to open up the power architecture and get it into other markets, right? Proprietary Unix market or very proprietary hardware with proprietary hypervisor and open source software is a great market, but we could expand it into more markets and then have more customers. And it turns out more customers is a good thing because the more things you sell, generally the better for profitability. Contrary to the belief of some companies I've worked for. It was also the idea to have more industry standard machines, have it licensed out the whole stack and let people, innovate where they want. Machines like this one, this is the open compute form factor barrel-eye system, which actually has open BMC on it. Hugh's celebrating at the back, so, talk to Hugh about why he's got his arms in the air celebrating. And indeed, at this point, it was very much clear that OpenPOWER was a very strategic direction for the company. And for this, I will say one point here is that when I say strategy, I mean strategy does not equal tactic. Those are two completely different ideas. So tactics are the means which we use to gain an objective, while a strategy is like the overall campaign. And this is used to achieve some kind of vision. So you can actually use these to separate out, what is the vision of the world you want, what are some strategies you can use to achieve that, and then what are individual tactics. So OpenPOWER is one of the strategic directions to have, a vision of much more power in the world. And so in order to achieve that, we have many individual tactics, right? And some are going to work well, others are going to require changing, and different people work on different ones, of course. It also helps if you have a strategic direction inside a company, especially when it's a large company, is that if you have an individual thing you want to do and achieve that you think will make the world better, if you can link that to one of those strategic directions in a solid way, it's much more likely you're going to get management support for that. Because you're basically then convincing someone that something that you want is relevant to something they want. So, at this point, we have a strategic direction, we have a new processor, we have a new abilities running KVM on power, new open source firmware, and new looking machines. So what is the most important thing to achieve with all of this going on in the different directions in the company? Pretty much. Step one, ship it. real artists ship, to quote someone who we all probably have heard that before. So in mid-2014, it was June, I think, we shipped the first power machine that could run KVM. And this was not, an ideal OpenPOWER machine. This is exactly the proprietary system with the proprietary firmware chopped out and now open source one plopped in and running Linux on the bare metal. So otherwise, it's exactly the same. And this was just an incremental change, right? It wasn't redesign the world. It was what is a stepping stone towards, this broader vision of OpenPOWER. There's a journey from that machine to like that OpenPOWER machine, so that transition between the more proprietary system with the Linux running bare metal to a much more open one, was actually rather short. So I looked back on it and went, wow, that was not much time. That was about a year. But with this first GA of like just a small stepping stone using the same hardware, replacing part of the stack, a seed was sown and we could grow from that to head towards where you wanted to. So the next step, of course, as we ship the system, the next step was to ship source code. So we had, something that was inside the company that was not public yet because you can't necessarily ship everything before the processor does. We had to release source code. That's pretty easy, right? Everyone knows git push. That's how you solve releasing source code for something big. And then all your problems are solved after git push. Well, there's details to that become a bit more interesting. So this is sort of the unique components for an OpenPOWER firmware build. There's host boot, which is about 400,000 klock of C++. The OCC firmware, which is about 70,000 lines of C. And ski boot itself, which is what I maintain, which is around 70. I say it was 70,000 lines. It's probably 80 or 90,000 lines by now. Lines of C as well. And these were all done by different teams. And in the case of host boot, it's actually many teams. So you have the core bit of host boot itself, and then you have hardware procedures that host boot runs in order to turn the chip on and get everything going. And host boot was also a new project in itself, because traditionally these IBM servers, right, were shipping with a service processor all the time. So why run all this fancy stuff inside the chip to turn the chip on when you've just got a service processor sitting there and you could write, real software because you have like memory and storage and like a debugger and all this kind of fancy stuff. So host boot itself was a new project, and even getting that integrated and running was a bit of organizational change in itself, very much a mindset change for those people writing hardware procedures. And at the same time as all of this, remember, we had all this old, enterprise market that was making all of the money. So as we're going to this push to go, how do we do an OpenPOWER system with open source firmware, we still at the same time say, don't break all of the stuff that makes all the money. That's probably not going to make your bank happy, and you probably want to get money out of the bank at some point. So don't break that. But it turns out when you publish a large amount of code at the start of the journey, people write nice little articles about how it's open source and great. But opening it all up didn't happen all at the same time. So as a progressive change, it was we don't have to publish everything at once. We could work with individual teams at time to say, okay, how are you going to publish your source code? How are you going to maintain that up there? And progressively publish things. So the OCC firmware code was a little later. Some of the host boot stuff was earlier. Some of the ski boot stuff was somewhere in the middle. And we had a lot of other stuff that went upstream into Linux first as well. So doing everything synchronized isn't necessarily needed. You don't need to construct the perfect world and do it straight out the door. You can do things gradually, and we definitely proved that. Initially, we had proprietary BMCs, which is AMI. We now have options there, so Supermicro make machines as well using their stack. We have OpenBMC-based machines as well. The idea being that it's a much more open environment. Everyone win on merit. And if anyone wants to send me a patch for some new service processor support, I will totally look at that and merge it. But this was enough. We had gradually released some stuff there. We had the nascent start of a community. We could get people shipping computers. And this is the Tyann reference system there that was released. And then we had things available commercially, which is all good. So if we look at the timeline here, in June 2014, we had the initial P8. We had the reference system soon after. We had all the code up on GitHub roughly about the same time. We then tagged 1.0, which mirrored what would ship with that machine. And there are other ones. And then we had what would ship with like a commercial P8 system, early ones, for OpenPOWER shortly after. And then we shipped some under an IBM label. So this was a whole bunch of change going on, right? You had something that was converting from a very proprietary development model of proprietary all the way down to some stuff being up just on GitHub, which bugs could even be reported there, or pull requests, or other such things. And how would we interact with that at the same time working with partners who may or may not have any familiarity with open source was all up in the air. And there were development communities like, most of us in Australia, right, are very intimately familiar with how free software communities work. Many people working on hardware procedures or other firmware may have not heard of a single thing about it. There is a Linux thing, yes, they've heard of it. And so there's very different attitudes going on. So getting to this point, though, of shipping the first big round of machines was not too difficult, right? You could get things going, and this was some amount of change, but not too much. It was pretty much what you'd expect for an initial whack. There were bugs, there were some people were more open and accommodating than others, and others you had to work with. But something left the building, and it wasn't Elvis leaving the building, it was products that then people bought, which is always a good sign. But the initial step of change is not the key to it all, right? You can initially enact some change, but you want to take that and make it last longer. So we didn't want to just release open source stuff and throw it over the wall. How do we then turn that into something that's intrinsic in developing firmware and open source firmware for OpenPOWER? And how do we have that mindset going where it is now some kind of open source community that is also blended between, you know, sort of company to company business relationships, including some stuff that may have to not be public until it's legally approved to be out there due to export, but also having a more open development community and have people know about there is this upstream world, let's work together, let's have things discussed in public rather than private, unless it actually has to be. How do we solidify that change? And that's sort of the real interesting part, because we all know, and can probably list several projects that are great, here's a new open source block of code, and it was Git push, and that is literally the last thing that happened to it. Right, and so this is you know, not what we wanted to have happen. We wanted to develop it further. So in stealing the how-to from a book called Leading Change, there's basically 8 steps to long-lasting fundamental organizational change. There is establishing urgency, creating a guiding coalition. That is, something needs to be done now. If you could do something if you have to do something now versus being told, I'll just do this whenever, which thing are you going to do? Where there's urgency, and this is what people act on. We all have way too many to-do things to do than we have time, therefore we do the most urgent, by default anyway. So creating a guiding coalition. If you got everyone inside IBM, or 400 and something thousand of them, and tried to decide on something, I'm pretty sure no one could decide on a drink of water. And this is true of any sufficiently large group, especially when you're trying to enact change in the group. What you want to do is get a smaller coalition of people together who have an idea that they want the change going and have a coalition to be able to work together and help enact that change. Develop vision and strategy. Right? Think about how you're going to enact change. Then communicate this out to people, right? So people start to get what you're trying to achieve. And then ensure that people, employees are empowered for board-based action. So people actually are able to act. And generate short-term wins, right? People like achievements. There is a reason that computer games go achievement unlocked. Right? Small rewards work really well. We are in a casino. Go read animal training books and then look at the design of poker machines. Short-term wins is how you train animals. People are animals. We're just generally larger ones with larger brains. Also, consolidate gains and produce more change. That is, encourage a cycle of change rather than go, yep, we're all done, stop. And anchoring new approaches in culture. That is, turn it into a culture of change. So it turns out that enacting this long-lasting organizational change, there's research on it, and other people have studied how this goes and how this fails. And this is one of the points I was like, there are people who know how brains work. Maybe we should ask them how to do some of this stuff, right? The software part's kind of easy because that's what we've been doing our whole lives. Other people have been studying how to make the people do things their whole lives. So we should definitely look at that. The other thing that's not so much relevant to my experience at IBM as much as it has been previously is that you can also have very dysfunctional teams. And you may have to go and examine how the team works together as a whole, or at least smaller teams, before you can start fixing sort of a broader organization. So there are, in fact, 5 dysfunctions of a team coming from another book that I found quite valuable in helping repair a team that was quite dysfunctional. So sometimes you have to do this concurrently rather than first and then the next, because we all know that you only ever do one thing at once. That's how the world works, so you may have to repair things. There may be an absence of trust. That is, you know, I don't trust you to do anything correct, and I don't trust you to be correct, and therefore we've got a problem working together. Fear of conflict, and this doesn't mean, you know, your code sucks and I hate you. This means ever having a discussion about what may be a contentious issue. If there is not a way to have a constructive discussion about something that you may not instantly agree on, then you have a dysfunction. You may have a lack of commitment to achieve anything. Beatings will continue until morale improves is a good one of that. And of course, an inattention, avoidance of accountability. Oh, it's not my fault. It's someone else's. and no one's accountable for anything. That's a dysfunction. And an inattention to results. If no one cares what the end product is, you definitely have a dysfunction. So, from all of this and looking at there, shipping is only the start. Our next to-do list was ship it again, have other people ship it, right? So have partners produce OpenPOWER machines and have them ship it and have them be successful and produce good quality machines. And of course, have a healthy development community, both inside and outside the company, and interacting well with others. And of course, like profit, because like, you know, that's a good thing to have, because then they can pay me money, and that's something I've become accustomed to. So here's some tales of like some issues that we encounter along the way. And these are some specific examples, and everyone's may be different. Bug trackers was a big one. This is a challenge for anyone starting a project. One, do you have one? Some people say no. Postgres still says no, I think, unless they changed recently. They may have one that's partially internal or partially external. Take, you know, MySQL, for example. And for IBM, of course, we had several. We have the Linux Technology Center has a Bugzilla instance, so that's internal, not external. The Power Firmware Group used ClearQuest, which was internal. And on ClearQuest, I will say, Bugzilla is the absolute height of bug tracker design and implementation. And this is probably true of every bug system that is not one of the two that I consider worth any salt. GitHub has GitHub, right? We're publishing our code on GitHub. And then we had GitHub special projects to interact with partners. So instead of opening up some firewall to some internal bug trackers, like, we'll just use GitHub issues on a private project. Turns out that's a brilliant idea. It requires no hosting. And then it's like adding permissions on GitHub. It's so easy. It's spookily good hack for getting things discussed. How do you maintain linkage? There's a slide on that. And also tears and booze. So, on top of this, of course, each system vendor had their own issue tracker internally to the company, necessarily, and sometimes you had several vendors incorporating the same machine. And at any one time, I think there was at least four bug trackers I needed to care about to ship any product. So how do you solve this? Well, you can kind of solve it with bug bridges. So there's another team that maintains bug bridges between some systems, but sometimes you just have to have a human who understands the big picture of what's actually going on. Because, you know, you may have 1,000 bugs, but maybe you only care about 3, but someone else is going to see 1,000 bugs and panic and all that fun. But a side quest, because side quests are fun and your life may be video games, and that certainly feels like it sometimes, is like Bugzilla performance. We had big problems with performance of the bug tracker, because I would run queries and then it would take a very long time and I'd be irritated, and then it would go offline for an hour that was just suspiciously during my workday, but not during the workday of certain parts of the United States. So obviously it didn't affect them. And this was actually on multiple bug trackers as well, not just Bugzilla. It was fun. And this was, I used to solve this problem, I used the exact same way as I did to solve anything bigger, right? Same 8 steps. Urgency, well, we need the bug tracker to work to ship a product. That's kind of urgent. Coalition, well, you gather the people that really care about Bugzilla working and some management who wants to make sure that you actually can ship a product. Vision and strategy is kind of a bit simple there. I cared about faster page loads. Other people cared about efficient workflow. So there was people there. Communicate was pretty easy there. Empower employees, you know, we involve the right people. So involve someone in a management chain who has power to tell someone to, yeah, go and do that and work on fixing that. We also involved others who were responsible, like, for managing that actual service. So the sysadmins there, and we tell them, hey, your stuff could be better. They're usually pretty enthused about, you know, getting resources to improve something. Generate short-term wins. We did. One of the first short-term wins was reconfigure MySQL to not use the default setup as of 15 years ago. And then it was, you know, from everywhere else, there was bonuses. It was like, could we tweak the VM? Could we get larger storage? Well, now we can move it to a cloud instance on a faster computer, set up replication and all that kind of jazz. All short-term wins. Consolidate gains and produce more change. Consolidating that was great. I benchmarked things and reported it out to everyone and say, thanks, you know, I can now look at bugs between 10 and 11 a.m. kind of deal. And this got a big, you know, improvement there. And anchoring approaches and culture is something that I didn't really think about too much here. So, you know, it seems to have helped a bit there, but I would say that something here when you're working on projects is, of course, to love your bug tracker, And this is not just for the reasons you may think. Bugs, databases provide metrics. And software development generally lacks metrics. You know, lines of code written per day is certainly not a metric I subscribe to. I try and have a lifetime contribution net zero lines of code would be my ideal. I'm not sure how I'm going on that. But there are some amount of metrics there, and this can be used to manipulate your management chain into doing your bidding. And this is because as the bugs decrease, or you can explain why it's increasing or what ones are important, you can build trust, right? When you look incompetent and you win you win allies, right? When you know what's going on, that's always a good thing. And when you have metrics to show that, yes, we are improving and we're coming up to a release and, you know, things aren't exponentially exploding, that's pretty good. Side quest, bug bridges. Yeah, for reasons that escape me, yeah, some people find it hard to use Bugzilla. And then we had the other issue is that for some of our machines, we're integrating with an existing process, right? Whenever I said that first machine there was just ripping out part of the stack and replacing it with ours, well, that was an existing product with all existing tooling. So really, if you're coming into an existing giant community, internal or external, their rules apply, right? You can't just say, you're doing it wrong. What the hell are you doing? Because they're going to tell you where to go, and that's not going to be anywhere nice. So we didn't try and change the world. We fixed some of the issues, and then we solved the rest with, you know, humans knowing what was going on. And I would say this, there is no substitute for knowing what the fire truck is going on. And I use the fire truck emoji here because I do actually mean what fires are actually fires. Where do you send the fire truck? There are some people who will jump up and down on certain things that are not fires. And you need to be able to reassure them of that. You need to have their trust that when you explain why that's not a real fire, that's actually an okay thing and they'll believe you. Anyone can print out a list of bugs and jump up and down. Competence is required to understand that and understand the implications of shipping a product with only a subset of those fixed. And my argument is that this bug list is way too small. I think we are doing inadequate QA. That was one of the arguments, which is on the try to win allies to build better QA systems. So knowledgeable communication throughout the hierarchy is important, especially important for winning allies when you want to enact some form of change, right? And communicating up through management is a skill, and it's a very different skill from communicating to other developers. The assumed knowledge is very, very different, right? When you're coming from a management perspective or something like that and senior in a company, you're coming from a completely different background than if you know the intricate workings of the 6502 processor and now this is your hobby and profession, right? There's completely different skill sets. And so bridging that gap and knowing how to communicate will definitely help. And it helps when you need to build a coalition for change, because management can be allies here. Rather than something to be fought against, you can bring people in to that coalition to enact change. So, how do we put together a team for change, even if it's a small effort? Well, you need position power, as in enough key players, be it technical, is always a good one, and management to ensure that it's hard to block change, right? A couple of strategically placed management people on your side when you're trying to enact big change makes it hard for some other manager to block that change. So therefore, winning management allies is useful when you want to overcome the management, not allies, and enact positive change. And you need expertise, right? You need experts relevant to the task at hand. You know, it's all well and good to say, I want to make Bugzilla faster, but if I have no one who knows how to sysadmin or change a MySQL configuration or, you know, bring up a cloud instance of a thing, then I'm not really likely going to get very far. Credibility. People with good reputation, so their pronouncements are taken seriously. It's all well and good to be the person who's angry on the internet. You need to be the person who is credible, right? You need someone with credibility in the area. And leadership, because you need people to drive it. And you need both management and leadership skills. And at this point, I will say leadership does not equal management. They are two very different skill sets and two completely different things. And this is something we might be more familiar with inside the free software world, right? You have technical leadership in various projects, but they are probably not your manager, right? They can't fire you from your job. and they can't deny you vacation time, right? That is something that is definitely a management task rather than a leadership task. And it's good to have very good relationships with your management in order to have your management related to things work really well, as well as have people who can focus on technical leadership, because as a technical leader, you probably don't want to be approving anyone's vacation time, unless that's someone's hobby. It's not mine. My policy of when I was directly managing people was take whatever you want, just, you know, get things done. I'm not keeping count, but please be ensured to take at least 4 weeks. Leaders come up with a vision, and managers plan, budget, and ensure it's implemented and help manage that process there. And never underestimate the importance of both of those, because they're both really important. And I will say on non-ideal people, you don't necessarily need to involve them in your change efforts. You can work around them. You can assemble a good small team to drive change, and this is in fact critical. And there's going to be people you don't like. In any large enough group, there's going to be people you don't like. You may not like slightly personally, you may not like them at all, you may not be able to stand them. And you may or may not be able to work with them to various degrees. And sort of managing that is important. You don't have to work with everyone who's going to be on your greeting card list, but at least having some kind of civility is important. And you may or may not involve people at various stages. It's just, learn to live one another with one another. A big issue with us, of course, was upstream versus product. As an organization that was incredibly product focused, right? Get it out the door. Like, incredibly product focused, to the extent that focusing on product plus one was sometimes a problem. We could focus on this product, but you'd never think about what could you change as a continuous stream to improve the deliverability of the subsequent one. And so for us, we needed to develop a community and support many products. And there were communities both inside the company and outside the company. And an important thing was to help sort of break down silos. There's this horrible idea of, tunnel vision towards one small bit, and to try and encourage people to own the entire stack and own both the product and the upstream is a tricky thing to balance, and I think we're making progress on it. And when we're interacting with external communities, of course, for example, kernel, upstreaming makes products easier, because when everything's upstream, creating a new product that's slightly different from what's there before is a much smaller delta. And indeed, we're trying to use this for our collection of all of this stuff in firmware, where if we upstream everything instead of branching off for each individual product and having long-lived branches, if everything's upstream and it's nice and small, creating new products is very easy and everything's all nice and well-tested and integral thing, and there's probably fewer regressions. So a bit of a vision was, upstream first, and upstream always works. Be good open source citizens, release at any time, short-lived forks for releases, not giant long-lived forks. And to have IBM not be any different than others, right? In an OpenPOWER community, we should not be some special exception that has magic rights. We're certainly knowledgeable, and I would encourage people to work with us because of that, but any other company shipping a machine or a product should be able to follow the same process and like, oh look, you've got a stable tree, well I'll just use that, or I'll maintain my small patches, but upstream them just like IBM does and be good examples. CI and testing was, of course, another big challenge that's ongoing. We had to, I've had to apply the magic change formula of the 8 steps during continuous integration and testing, and then, automation of testing, and then how do we automate testing for multiple different types of products? Not only that, but then how do we package up the test suite itself as a product so that others can consume it? Because we're not going to be the ones running, regression tests for every single possible OpenPOWER computer in the entire world. That may be a bit hard. And this was one of the areas where there's a bit more management product focus rather on efficiencies from one product to the next. And there's, it's been a rocky road, but we're making some progress there. I'm kind of nice. So communicate is always good. I've very much focused on communicating things that would be wins for people. So like, hey, if we do this, like release and test effort will be less, as in you will have less work if you do it this way. And that tends to win. And for us, we have a lot of people who care a lot about shipping high quality products. They've done this for years, sometimes decades, and a lot, zero open source experience. So sitting down with people and talking through your different views of the world there is actually really, really valuable, because you see something from a different perspective. So if something you see is an absolutely insane way to do things, it is probably a sane way to do things in some different context. And understanding that context and them understanding why you think that's a weird way to do things will foster, you know, some kind of collaboration there on coming from a common ground of understanding to come up with a new way to change things for the better that doesn't, you know, mess anyone up. Sometimes this works face-to-face best. I reckon I can save, you know, $1 million with a $2,000 FA. Empower employees for broad-based action. This can require management support, of course, so that's fun. Want a short-term win, though? Tag a release. This is the easiest thing ever. Short-term wins, git tag and writing release notes is like the easiest part of this all. Communicating out changes is great. You know, kudos works great. Never underestimate thanking someone. Like, never at all. It doesn't even have to be monetary value in all of this there, but generate kudos and evidence that someone can use as evidence to their manager about why they should get a promotion and a pay raise. Right? So reward people who are doing good by saying thank you, that they're doing something really great. Because this will help people and you win allies, you know. Nice job is something, a positive thing to enrich someone's life that you can do, and they will more likely do things similar again. Positive reinforcement works really well. This is how you train your dog to do good things. It's also how you train people. We are, after all, just monkeys in shoes. And this has been moderately successful, right? There's tweaking going on, and I do not have a good answer for getting consistently good code review from many people. I haven't found that magic formula yet, which is unfortunate. Consolidate gains and produce more change. The worst thing you can do when you've done a certain amount of change is to go to everyone and say, well done, everyone. That was a good amount of change. Everyone take a well-deserved break. Because guess what happens next?
More change.
No, no more change. Everyone's like, well, that's done then. Good. Don't have to change anything. And especially those who may have opposed the change, maybe very loud in that celebration, but not then continue, have any effort. And in fact, you may regress from that change. So this is a critical time after the initial wins is to look at what's next. What do we change next? Snowball it. Drive more change. Use that coalition of people that you gather to do that change and grow it, maybe, and seek out more change. Have another coalition to do different change. But be sustainable, right? Don't burn people out. Right? Watch burnout rates, do sustainable workloads, but look at what else you can change. And the other thing, of course, is anchoring new approaches in culture. So culture is way more ingrained than behavior, and it's often invisible. It's the things that, when asked to write down what is your culture, culture is actually what you don't write down. It's all those things that you just implicitly assume because they're so obvious, why would you put them down? When discussing this the other day, I mentioned that I'm wearing pants. This is just part of the culture of when you show up to a conference, you are dressed. That's so ingrained, no one would ever write that down as a thing of like, you know, just be dressed. They may say, oh, be dressed in this kind of way, but there's never don't not be dressed. Right, and this is why it's really hard to talk about. You should have a respect for the old way of doing things. It's probably done for a reason. That reason may no longer be relevant, so your culture may be a product of things that are no longer true, but that culture somewhat exists. And in order to affect that is the hardest part of it all. So provide evidence of change. Prove it. Like, oh, you did this thing. Is it better? A previous metric I used was how many releases we could get out in a year, right? And we doubled it year on year with point releases and bug fixes. And this is a very positive thing to show because that directly related to customer happiness because they got their bug fixes in really, really quickly. And sometimes, unfortunately, the way to change is with turnover of staff, right? Not everyone is going to be along for the ride. And sometimes you have to be okay with this. And people leave for many reasons. It's not about, you know, rejecting, you know, this kind of change effort. There can be everything going on in life. But I have had the experience where the way to really solidify it is someone decided, you know, they were better off elsewhere. And they were. And everyone was much happier. And today, everyone is in a great place, and many other members of that team have moved on to other places as well, and everyone's still great. Yeah, it's not Chris. So things that aren't fixed. I wanted to say things that I totally are currently struggling what to do. That's a pretty relevant list there. I won't talk about RFC compliant email. But anyway, in summary, software problems are easy. Hardware problems are easy, right? Percussive maintenance fixes everything. Human problems are hard. Be pragmatic. You can't fix everything in the world. and you can't fix everything in the world now, right? Real fundamental change takes time, but it's totally worth it. And with that, I think we have time for some questions, and I will lead up your homework. Why is that not showing up? I will bring up the homework in an Emacs buffer because that's the most appropriate thing I could ever think of. And at that time, we can have our change.
The dog ate our homework.
The dog did indeed eat our homework. So, five dysfunctions of a team, leadership fable, leading change, who says elephants can't dance, and nonviolent communication. And I'll see if I can make that go as well at the same time. But yes, thank you. Questions?
Hi, Stuart. You started the talk with the OpenPOWER group established.
Mm.
Could you comment briefly on how that started up, how you got the high-level management buy-in that it was a good concept to start with?
That's probably a talk in and of itself, and one that I wasn't party to, so I didn't want to speak on it. But I think it was sort of pressures from several places, including, you know, up high. So a lot of good buy-in. I don't know which direction this all came from. I think it came from several directions where several people had roughly the same idea and to start it going. So I don't really know the full story of that enough to summarize it, but it certainly helped that was already in existence, right? So the overall vision was kind of already there. So sorry, I don't have an answer.
I have a feeling you're going to say this one is a topic for another talk. RFC compliant email, discuss.
No. 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 No.
There, I think that's corporate approved. Any other questions? Thoughts, tears, efforts to drive major change, inquiries on different parts of the Skiboot source code or power processes, offers to code review?
Given the project involves other organizations,
mm.
is any of this also around how you're trying to help them produce organizational change, or is this pretty much an insular IBM thing still at the moment?
That is exactly the question I wanted someone to ask so I could provide this stuff in there. So yes, is part of that. And we've gone through, there was one partner who was pretty reluctant to share some source. It turns out for some of the source they didn't want to share, they didn't have to because Apache 2 license versus GPL and other stuff, rah, rah, rah. And we worked really closely with them and drove a lot of this kind of change through that org, up our org chart, up their org chart, through all the reasons why you should do that to make our lives easier. In the end, we were successful, and I would currently say they are a model of sending things upstream to us through that effort. And it was painful and long, and I wish we didn't have to go through it because everyone should just see the world how I see it, and everything would be a lot easier. But through that, I think it's been beneficial both to them to be able to ship better machines. In fact, it was crucial for them, the last thing they shipped, having that all upstream and done and having gone through that was critical to even remotely getting it out the door. Might have been a week late, but it wasn't 3 months late. And that was critical to it. And after they saw the benefit of that, I recently got patches for stuff that I wasn't even otherwise aware of. So there is a machine support from them that a machine I didn't know was going to exist, which is exactly the way I want it to work. I don't want to have to understand the entire world. I cannot. And that was, in that case, worth it. And we'll be working with them in the future, so that's great.
On behalf of LCA, just a little...
Oh, thank you very much.
And can we all thank Stuart?
Thank you. I will make that list available and tweet it and blog it and other such things and possibly the source code to the talk if you really care.